Academy. So here are the current topics of daily current affairs dated on 1st August 2019, and today's topics are as follows. Atal Community Innovation Center. Here the government of India has launched the Atal Community Innovation Center in New Delhi to encourage the spirit of innovation at the community level. So in this article I'll be explaining you about the Atal Community Innovation Center and its prospects. And coming to the next important article, it's about external commercial borrowings. So basically, the external commercial borrowings is an instrument used in India to facilitate Indian companies, that are most probably like private or public companies, to raise money outside the country in foreign currency. So external commercial borrowing is a source of foreign exchange reserves, and it is facilitating the Indian companies to raise the money outside the country. So basically it refers to commercial loan, which can be in the form of loans, bonds, securitized instruments, etc., but with a minimum average maturity of 3 years. Whatever the bonds and loans we are taken under this commercial loan mechanism, that is external commercial borrowing, it has a minimum average maturity of 3 years. So I'll be explaining you the recent dynamics and recent changes in the concept of external commercial borrowings and these meanings and prospects. So coming to the very next important article, is about the Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill 2019. So it's basically, we refer it as Triple Talaq Bill. So the parliament passed the Muslim Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill 2019 with an objective that this bill would help in protecting the rights of married Muslim women and prevent divorce by practice of talaq-e-bidat, that is triple talaq, by their husband. So I'll be explaining you what are the salient features of this bill. And the very next one is about the cabinet nod for more judges in Supreme Court. Basically, the Supreme Court is being subjected to the backdrop of raising cases in the in it, and the Union Cabinet approved increasing the number of judges in the Supreme Court from present 31 to 34, including the Chief Justice of India. So including the Chief Justice of India, now the Cabinet has approved the raise of number of judges in the Supreme Court to 34 from 31. And this can be done as per the Supreme Court Number of Judges Act 1956. I'll be explaining you about the Judges Act, and I'll be explaining you the current dynamics of pendency of cases in Supreme Court in this article. The very next important is article is about, it's about 10% quota case for statute bench. Basically, the 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act provided the 10% economical reservation, that is reservation on the basis of economic status, for general category people. So our constitution allows the reservation on social, educational and political basis, but it does not allow the reservation on the basis of economic criteria, where this act is providing the reservation on the basis of economic quota. So 1992 lo the same case study, when program was launched by the then Prime Minister P.V. Narasimha Rao. So that program came under judicial review, and Supreme Court has struck down the provision of providing the reservation on the basis of economic criteria. Now this case, that is the validity of the 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act, is going to be examined by the statute bench of Supreme Court. And next important article is about the plan for single water disputes tribunal. Basically, we have different water disputes tribunal, so that depends upon the regional, that may be like northern region water dispute tribunal, southern, western, central, eastern. So the cabinet has been thought of a plan to launch single water disputes tribunal, so as to integrate all the cases, all the necessity of different states, and so as to bring a comprehensive and effective resolution mechanism for the water disputes. And next one is, what are for economically weaker section in Jammu and Kashmir. Basically, the same concept is being manifested in 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act, providing the reservation quota for economically weaker section in India. But in the case of Jammu and Kashmir, it is different, where the acts can only be applied to the state of Jammu and Kashmir only when that particular act is being, I mean, has been passed in the Jammu and Kashmir State Legislative Assembly, that's Jammu and Kashmir Constituent Assembly. So now that Jammu and Kashmir Constituent Assembly is planning to introduce the bill which has the prospects of providing the reservation quota for economically weaker section in Jammu and Kashmir. And the next article is Cabinet okays hike in subsidy for sulfur-based fertilizers. So in the current agricultural practices, it is the sulfur-based fertilizer which dominated the industry of fertilizer, which is very important input for the crop cultivation. And these are, I mean, these sulfur-based fertilizers are heavily consumed by the like farmers for their cultivation purposes. And Cabinet has come up with a proposal to increase the amount which is given to the farmers under the subsidy for sulfur-based fertilizers. And in this article, I'll be explaining you the Cabinet decision on this and the sulfur-based fertilizers and its importance to the cultivation of crops. So these are the number of topics we are going to discuss in our today's daily current affair. So let us move on to the first article, that is about Atal Community Innovation Center. So in news, the government of India launched Atal Community Innovation Center in New Delhi to encourage the spirit of innovation at the community level. So basically, now the concept of employment is being driven not by creating job, not by, I mean, seeking jobs. It is driven by the creating jobs. Like, it is fostering, it is encouraging the entrepreneurs, whereby they could create a number of jobs where a large number of unemployed youth could be observed. In this way, the problem of unemployment could be addressed and solved to an extent in our country within a very near future, with the help of these type of programs and institutions. So about Atal Community Innovation Center, this initiative has been launched under the Atal Innovation Mission, a flagship initiative of Niti Aayog. So here you have to concentrate about the Atal Innovation Mission comes under the initiative of Niti Aayog. It was not launched by any ministry. It was launched by the, it was a just an initiative of Niti Aayog, National Institution for Transformation of India, for Transforming India, Aayog. The purpose of this new initiative is to make innovation ecosystem socially inclusive, as well as to ensure equitable distribution of infrastructure for innovation across the country. So the main purpose of Atal Innovation Mission is to boost the innovation ecosystem, innovation environment, whereby all the people, irrespective of their social differences, will be included into the ecosystem of the innovation. Though that is called socially inclusive, and it also ensure the fruits of this innovation ecosystem to be distributed on an equitable basis. What are the fruits? Those fruits are nothing but infrastructure. Whatever the infrastructure provided under this innovation ecosystem will be distributed among all without any discrimination on an equitable basis in order to boost innovation among innovation in the country. So the Atal Community Innovation Center has been launched to focus on the 484 backward districts where the innovation infrastructure is very weak. So this Atal Community Innovation Center has came up with a program which came up with an initiative to focus on the backward district number 484 in our country, where the innovations infrastructure is very weak. This new program has been specifically designed for undeserved, unserved regions of tier one or metro cities. You can say the metro cities, where the cities have the population more than 10 lakh people. Tier 2 and Tier 3 cities, smart cities, aspirational districts, northeastern states, Jammu and Kashmir, as well as the rural and tribal regions of India. So obviously, a comprehensive mission, comprehensive program where we are covering each and every pocket and region of the country, ensuring the fruits of innovation to every pocket of the country. So coming to the MCQs, consider the following statements regarding the Atal Innovation Mission. It is a flagship initiative under the Ministry of Science and Technology. Wrong. It is a flagship initiative under the Niti Aayog. Under the Niti Aayog. So first one is wrong. The purpose is to make innovative ecosystem socially inclusive and to ensure equitable distribution of infrastructure for innovation. Yes, this is the purpose behind the launch of this Atal Innovation Center. So only two is correct. So answer is B. So coming to the next important article about external commercial borrowings. So in news, the Reserve Bank of India has relaxed external commercial borrowings norms for corporates, non-banking lenders as a move towards easing liquidity. So it is the corporates and non-banking institutions which raise the money, which is out of the country in the form of foreign currency. That is that. It's basically we call it in a simple terms in raising of commercial loan by these entities, and that commercial loan is nothing but external commercial borrowings, and that external commercial borrowings norms has been relaxed by Reserve Bank of India only with the objective towards easing liquidity, to increase liquidity in the market, to increase the level of foreign exchange reserves availability in the market. So what are the recent changes? The Reserve Bank of India has liberalized the end use stipulation for external commercial borrowings, both for corporates as well as liquidity-starved non-banking lenders. So the liberalization will be applicable to external commercial borrowings taken for working capital, general corporate purpose loans, or repayment of rupee loans. The external commercial borrowings can be taken for a wide variety of reasons, but these relaxed norms provided by the Reserve Bank of India can be applicable only to the ECBs taken for working capital and general corporate purpose loans or repayment of rupee loans. Corporate borrowers will be able to avail the ECBs to repay rupee loans taken for capital expenditure if they are into manufacturing or infrastructure building and classified as special mention account, that is called SMA. Special mention account, SMA2, or non-performing asset under any one-time settlement arrangement with lenders. Basically, the ECBs can be taken to repay the loans taken in the form of rupees. That is called domestic loans, domestic commercial loans. So, in order to repay the domestic commercial loans, these ECBs can be taken, and those ECBs has the relaxed norms as per the recent change by the Reserve Bank of India. So coming to the meaning, an external commercial borrowing is an instrument used in India to facilitate Indian companies to raise money outside the country in foreign currency. It refers to commercial loans, which can be in the form of bank loans, bonds, securitized instruments, buyer's credit and supplier's credit, available from non-resident lenders with a minimum average maturity of 3 years. This is a very important. Average maturity is 3 years. ECBs availed of by residents are governed by the Foreign Exchange Management Act, that is FEMA Act 1999, along with the Foreign Exchange Management Borrowing or Lending in Foreign Exchange Regulations 2000, as amended from time to time. So the regulation will be done as per the two laws. So coming to the MCQs, consider the following statements regarding ECBs. External commercial borrowing is an instrument used in India to facilitate Indian companies to raise money outside the country in the foreign currency. Correct. ECBs availed of by residents are governed by the Foreign Exchange Management Act 1999 and also the Foreign Exchange Management Borrowing or Lending in Foreign Exchange Regulation. That is Foreign Exchange Management and Regulation, simply we can say it, in 2002 also. So both the statements are correct. So coming to the next important article is about the Triple Talaq Bill. That is, technically we call it as Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill 2019. So recently the Parliament has passed the Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill 2019. So coming to its objectives, this bill would help in protecting the rights of married Muslim women. and protect and prevent divorce by practice of talaq bidat by their husbands. So coming to the salient features of the bill, it declares the practice of triple talaq as void and illegal. Void is not enforceable by the law. It makes this offense punishable with imprisonment up to 3 years and fine. It provides for payment of subsistence allowance to married Muslim women and dependent children, and that children will be taken into the custody of Muslim women if they are minors. It proposes to make the offense cognizable. Cognizable means like in conscience the offense been committed if information relating to the committing of an offense is given to a police officer by the married Muslim woman upon whom talaq is pronounced, or by any person related to her by blood or marriage. The offense is made compoundable with the permission of the magistrate at the instance of the married Muslim woman upon whom talaq is pronounced. So it is the magistrate who decides upon the offense regarding triple talaq. It further provides for hearing the married Muslim woman upon whom talaq is pronounced before the accused is released on bail by the magistrate. Even though the accused is being sought to get the bail by the magistrate, before getting the bail, that hearing would be done in the presence of the married Muslim woman upon whom talaq, triple talaq is pronounced. So coming to the MCQs, they have given two statements. The bill would help in protecting the rights of married women and prevent divorce by practice of triple talaq, that is talaq bidat by their husbands. So first statement is correct. It declares the practice of triple talaq as void and legal. Wrong. It declares the practice of triple talaq as void. Correct. But it is legal. It's not legal. So only first statement is correct. Answer is yes. So cabinet not for more judges in Supreme Court. Acting at the request of the Chief Justice of India, the Union Cabinet decided to increase the number of Supreme Court judges from 31 to 34. So at present we have 31 judges including the Chief Justice of India, and it has been decided to raise the number from 31 to 34 including Chief Justice of India. Details. The move comes against the backdrop of the raising number of cases in the top court, which stands at nearly 60,000. At present, the sanctioned strength of the court is 30, excluding the Chief Justice of India. According to a written reply by the Law Ministry to a Rajya Sabha question on July 11th, 59,331 cases are pending in the top court. So coming to the background, way back in 1988, about 3 decades ago, the judge strength of Supreme Court was increased from 18 to 26. And again, after 2 decades in 2009, it was increased to 31, including the Chief Justice of India. Now it has been proposed to increase from 31 to 34. So what is the procedure of increasing judges? The strength of Supreme Court is fixed by law made by the Parliament as per Article 124, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. Therefore, the strength can be increased by way of parliamentary legislation. So this is about the increase in number of Supreme Court judges by the cabinet not. So coming to the next important article regarding the 10% quota for statute bench. The 3-judge bench of the Supreme Court led by Justice S.A. Bobde reserved its order on the question of referring a batch of petitions challenging the validity of constitutional amendment. There is 103rd constitutional amendment providing 10% academic quota in government jobs and education institutions to a constitutional bench. Basically, it is a classic example of judicial review. So coming to the key facts about the 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act. The important components of 103rd Constitutional Amendment are, first one, the amendment changed 2 fundamental rights, that is Article 15 and 16. The amendment provides for the advancement of the economically weaker section of the society by providing the impetus in the form of by addressing economical grievances of them. The amendment aims to fulfill the commitments of the directive principles of state policy under Article 46 to promote the educational and economic interests of the weaker sections of the society. So we have the area of territorial principles of state policy to be addressed under the Article 46, where the Article 46 is mandating to promote the education and economic interests of the weaker sections of the society by the state. The constitutional amendment is yet to pass the judicial scrutiny, since the Supreme Court had set the cap of 50% on reservation, whereby providing this 10% is exceeding this cap. The Youth for Equality has questioned the constitutional validity of the 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act, which was passed by both the Houses of Parliament after being presented as the Constitutional 124th Amendment Bill 2019. The example of Tamil Nadu is being cited to propose that there are ways and means to protect the amendment from the Supreme Court declaring it unconstitutional. So here you need to refer to as Tamil Nadu ka Reservation Act, whereby around 1999, the state of Tamil Nadu has provided around 69% of the reservation in the employment and education institutions for the Tamil Nadu people, exceeding the 50% of reservation mandated by the Supreme Court in the Indira Sahani case. So, but it was justified as per the 69% reservation is necessary, as the number of groups, social groups, which has no adequate representation in the government jobs and education are quantifiably more, whereby it necessitated and justified the provision of 69% of reservation provided to those Tamil Nadu people. So here it says that the example of Tamil Nadu is being cited to propose that there are ways and means to protect the amendment from the Supreme Court declaring it unconstitutional. Gujarat has become the first state to implement the 10% quota reserved for people from economically weaker section proposed under the 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act. So coming to the criterion for reservation, people who have an annual income of less than 8 lakh rupees, or people who own less than 5 acres of farmland, or people who have a house lesser than 1000 square feet in a town. So these are the criteria for reservation. This is all about 103rd Constitutional Amendment Act. And next, coming to the plan for single water dispute tribunal. The Lok Sabha passed a bill that promises faster redressal of water disputes between the states by putting in place a new architecture of tribunals that handle interstate water disputes comprehensively in an integrated manner too. Moving the Interstate River Water Disputes Amendment Bill 2019 for passage in the Lok Sabha, Jal Shakti Minister Gajendra Singh Shekhawat said the existing tribunals constituted to resolve water disputes had failed, and in some cases, even after 33 years, the tribunals were yet to give an award. That is, were yet to give a verdict upon that cases. The original Interstate River Water Disputes Act, enacted in 1956, was amended 17 years ago to make 5 years the maximum period within which the river water disputes need to be resolved. But the reality had been different. We have already seen, even after 33 years, there are some cases are pending with the tribunals. The new bill proposes that the final award will be delivered in 2 years, and whenever it gives the order, the verdict will be notified automatically in the gazette. Coming to the prospects of new bill, it provides for the constitution of a single tribunal with different benches and the setting of strict timelines for adjudication. A retired Supreme Court judge will head the tribunal, and benches will be formed as and when required. The states can approach the tribunal for resolution of their disputes, and once resolved, the bench would wind up. So here the important lines you have to note it down is, the chairman of this tribunal is going to be a retired Chief Justice, retired Supreme Court judge, and whatever the other benches formed under this single water tribunal, tribunal is ad hoc in nature, is temporary in nature. When the resolution of a particular dispute is being resolved, is being sorted out, then the bench would wind up, will be terminated. this is about the new bill. Coming to the next important article is about quota for economically weaker sections in Jammu and Kashmir. And in news, the cabinet approved a bill to provide up to 20% reservation in Jammu and in jobs and educational institutions for the economically weaker sections in Jammu and Kashmir. Details: the Union Cabinet, chaired by Prime Minister, approved the Jammu and Kashmir Reservation Second Amendment Bill 2019, whereby it would pave the way for extending the benefits of reservation of up to 10% for economically weaker sections in educational institutions and public employment, alongside existing reservation to the Jammu and Kashmir also. Coming to the background, the 10% quota for economically weaker sections will be in addition to the existing reservations in Jammu and Kashmir. In January, the centre approved a constitutional amendment to provide a 10% reservation to the economically weaker section for direct recruitment in government jobs and higher education institutes. This quota is over and above the reservation cap of 50%. The centre has defined those with an annual income of less than 8 lakh rupees as economically weaker. The Supreme Court had earlier refused to stay the center's decision to grant 10% quota in jobs admission to economically weaker section of the citizens. This is I am talking about during the era of P.V. Narasimha Rao in 1992. The quota will be over and above the existing 50% reservation to scheduled caste, scheduled tribes and other backward class, whereby it may face the judicial scrutiny under judicial review. So coming to the cabinet, OKS hike in subsidy for sulfur-based fertilizers. In the news, the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs, headed by Prime Minister, gave its nod for raising the subsidized prices for sulfur-based fertilizers. Whatever the decision related to the agriculture will be taken by the CCEA, that is Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs. And the aim is to discourage rampant use of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium fertilizers, which impacts soil quality. In order to discourage the usage of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium fertilizers, these sulfur-based fertilizers have been encouraged under this initiative. Details: for sulfur-based fertilizers, the government will provide a subsidy of 350 rupees per 100 kg against 277 rupees earlier. The government's total subsidy burden for nutrient-based fertilizers is 22,875.5 crores. The move is part of steps taken by the Modi-led government to improve the agriculture productivity and ease agrarian distress during its second consecutive term, and the Narendra Modi government is focusing on Gaon Garib Kisan. So what is the reason behind this initiative? The center has hiked the subsidy for sulfur-based fertilizers while keeping unchanged the subsidy rates for nitrogen, phosphorus and potash based fertilizers in a bid to correct imbalances and ensure better soil health. That is the rationality behind this. So students, these are the number of articles which today we have discussed. Hope you enjoyed the video. So all the best. Thank you very much.